Templates in UI Toolkit are extremely powerful tools to allow us to create reusable components for our UIs. Basically, anytime that we're going to want to use a particular component in multiple places, we can create a template that allows us to extract out the UXML and even attach some code to that so we don't have to repeat ourselves making that same thing in all of these different places. Hey, Chris here from LlamAcademy, here to help you. Ooh, me? Yes, you! Make your game dev dream become a reality by helping you level up your UI toolkit game. Templates can be used either for editor tooling or for runtime UIs. In this video, we're going to look at the runtime UIs, but they work the same either way. Like I was saying earlier, there's two main benefits of using a template. Number one, we can create a reusable component that we can then inject into other screens, like this level selection modal. I'm using it both on the main menu and on the runtime UI, and it's very easy to just inject that in there. Then number two, that allows us to abstract out the UXML and a backing class away from these screens so we can make changes only in one isolated place. With these two in mind, let's take a look at the first one where we're making a reusable component. You're already a little bit familiar with this menu because we've been looking at it so far. In this main menu scene, we have a game object called main menu, which just has this UI document that will render what we see for the UI, pointing to a visual tree asset, and has a main menu mono behavior that is the backing class for this particular menu. On the UI, we have only four buttons. They're the standard UI toolkit buttons. There's nothing fancy here. I've just applied some styling. When we click on one of them is when we have the interesting things happen. When we click play, we're showing a template. This is what we're calling the level selection modal. It also has a backing class that is not a mono behavior. Notice you don't see any level selection mono behavior here on the right. It's just a standard C# class. The same goes for the about and how to play. Both of these are templates, and the backing class is controlling what happens when we click on any of these buttons. If we press X, it should close. If we click any of these things, it takes you somewhere else. And the how to play only worries about closing itself. The level selection modal is reused across both this main menu scene, and if we load a level by clicking on one of these, we'll load a new scene, the game scene, which behaves very similarly. We have the runtime UI game object with a runtime UI backing class and a UI document that will show what we see on the screen. When we click this pause button, we see a similar menu to what we saw before, and we've still got our level selection modal. So when we click on that, we're using the exact same template, which has the exact same backing class. There's a little bit of setup that we can tell that this needs because we see these levels and these are dynamically populated. So the class that uses this has to provide it the context of what are the available levels and what is the player's best score on that particular level. And it still works the same. If we click any level, we will load that scene and build out this new level. And we can keep doing all this and come back to the main menu if we give up. That paradigm of having a backing class is very important. If our main menu has to know about everything that happens in all of these modals, we lose a lot of the benefits because then whatever class is going to use any of these templates has to know about everything that happens in each one of them. So having a class that controls what happens in this modal is hugely beneficial and gives us a lot of the benefits that we're talking about here. If we take a look at the UI builder for the main menu, we can see we just have a little menu on the inside that has all of our buttons, and we have three templates, the level selection, about game, and tutorial. Each one of these is referring to a different UXML document. Longtime viewers will know that I'm not a fan of the UI builder, so let's take a look at the UXML. This is our raw main menu UXML. We can see a few things here. Number one is we have to define a template first. We've got the template tag saying the name of each template, which is very important, as well as the path to the UXML document itself. Then we can use the instance tag, telling it it's an instance of which template. That's why the name is very important. They have to match. And if you were for any reason to leave out a template, maybe you're copy pasting stuff around and you forgot to define the template, it's not going to work right. You need to make sure you have both the template and the instance. And you can have as many instances as you want as well. It just so happens that each of these is only used one time. But just putting the instance and the template on your UXML doesn't necessarily do anything for you. You probably have to set up that instance somehow, especially if you're using a backing class. If we take a look at the main menu backing class, this is one of the areas that we have a reference to our level selection modal, right? We can see that's defined here at the class level. And on awake, we can see that we're creating a new instance of that backing class and telling it, hey, here's the root element that belongs to you. That's the document root visual element, query visual element of name level selection. In the level selection constructor, we're doing things like making sure we have that level prefab that we're going to instantiate in the list view and calling a function called initialize. What this does is calls set visual elements and register button callbacks. In another video, I'll get into how I have this entire UI set up. It's related, but not necessary for understanding how templates work. The important part is when we create an instance of the level selection modal, the backing class, we have to do some operations on the elements within this instance, such as get our scroll view. Because in this particular example, we're going to add a bunch of items to this scroll view. And we need to know which element on the current UI document are we operating on, because remember, this is a standard C# class. If we consider that the visual element named root and all of its children are effectively injected into any other UXML document that's using this template, that paints a pretty clear picture of why we need to know where we're being injected. If we only search this small subtree, we can easily identify whatever elements we're looking for. In this particular case, we're looking for that scroll view and the label called close button. If we come back to the main menu, we can see why it's important that we query for this particular instance of the template and provide it that element that it should operate out of, as well as provide any other data that that template needs to be effective. We can see the exact same pattern applied to that about modal and the tutorial modal. On about, when we're setting the visual elements, we're just querying for these buttons and setting up which callbacks should happen on each button press. This is a great example of our second use case of just abstracting code away from our main screen. Even though this template is only used in one place on the main menu, our main menu doesn't have to know all the insides about what should we do on all these buttons. We've moved that away to its own page or its own modal. That keeps our main page focused on only the things that it knows about, not all the sub pages or the sub menus of all of the things inside of it. The tutorial modal is an even simpler one because all it can do is close itself. It displays some text and closes itself. The key takeaway here is we can define a reusable component that can be injected into some other UXML. So we don't have to implement that UXML in every single place that we want it to be. We can attach that backing class to control the behavior and whatever else is going on there. It gives us only one place to make those changes. And I hope this real life example of making a template and using it in multiple locations helped you better understand how they work and how you can implement them into your own game. If you got value out of this video, make sure you've liked and subscribed. There we go. To help the channel grow, reach more people, and add value to more people. And if you want to show your support for LlamAcademy, there's a few ways you can do that. You can get yourself some LlamAcademy merch right here on YouTube. You can use the affiliate links down in the description if you're doing your Humble Bundle or Unity Asset Store shopping, or you can become a YouTube member or a Patreon supporter. Both of those will get your name up here on the screen at the end of every video. You get access to a members exclusive Discord and a shout out starting at the awesome tier, like Ivan, Ifiabolis, Mustafa, Angel, Sneddon, Nick5454, and Pixel Wizards. There's also all of these great supporters as well. Thank you all for your support. I am so incredibly grateful.